To the May 19th, 2016 Town of Poughkeepsie Planning Board meeting. Please join me in the salute to our flag.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. First order of business, public hearing, Spin Bowls Outdoor Recreation is going to be adjourned. I move that the planning board adjourn the site plan public hearing to July 21st, 2016.
Second.
Moved and seconded, call the question, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries 5-0, that is now adjourned until July 21st. Is there anyone in the audience that wishes to comment on any other agenda items? I should ask for a motion, but that's okay. Plan review, children's home, site plan. Let me get my notes. Children's home addition, site plan review regarding a two-story addition to the main building for kitchen, dining, and office and support spaces, and work site for parking and a new building entry ramp. 36 Children's Way, zoned R20, resident single family, 20,000 square feet, district 24.4 acres. It's a non-listed action. Children's home owner, children's home is the owner. Okay. Whose project is this? Eric?
Yeah. Chairman, can I just hand out a couple of site plan just so you can see?
Yes. Please do. Turn my sound off here.
Different from the one that we have?
No, just so you had it. No, I didn't.
Okay.
Try and access.
Thank you.
Within the same.
Yes.
Hey, we got it all covered.
This is the same.
It's the same. Okay, Eric?
Sure. Staff is recommending tonight that the planning board waive the site plan public hearing on this, and also that it conclude its seeker review. We feel it's ready, and that it move to a conditional site plan approval. Since last time, there's been some additional information provided. The plans have been refined somewhat. We do have two sets of plans, civil and architectural. They need to be integrated a little bit better, but the overall project is pretty clear on the plans, and aside from some details, we feel like it's ready to move forward. I just direct your attention, there was one issue we'd had asked about previously regarding parking, just in terms of the analysis. The board wasn't too concerned with it. We wanted to nail down the numbers, and we extracted some of that information from the application that seems to be relevant, and staff's of the opinion that there's sufficient parking on site. I think that's pretty much it. I know the engineer is not here tonight. He had noted, I think his...
I believe Mr. Wallace is filling in for the engineer.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Do that. He was...
attorney, engineer, I don't know. No, okay.
He simply had noted a couple of days ago, their comments are in here. I guess their main thing was they just wanted to understand better. And Chris, you might want to address this for the board.
Sure.
It looks like there's a lot of, they just want to clarify, it looks like there's a lot of fill coming into the site for the parking area northeast of the building that will require raising it some. And also to be dealt with going forward on the plans, just to clarify the drainage and the fill and how it's working in relationship to the building and the downspouts.
Yeah, I can go over that briefly with you right now. So we are bringing.
Can you give me one face? Just can you bring it like 4 feet closer?
Sure.
No, but I want to make it. I want to make it better for you guys. You got to take pity on these. No. There you go. Thank you.
So,
you got to take the microphone. I can hear you, but they got to pick it up on the audio and the video for the television audience. No.
Now?
Yes.
All right. So we're adding some fill in the northeast portion
of the expanded parking area here. And the intent of that fill is to create a slope which would allow the drainage to sheet in either direction. And it's minuscule in nature. It's not significant in terms of the amount of fill. It fluctuates from about, you know, 0 inches to about a foot in order to get about a 1 to 2% slope on the pavement. With regards to the drainage will continue to flow to the east, down towards the basketball court. That's the current path of it. There are two 12-inch pipes there that discharge further to the east and go out into a small little pond area that's existing on the property.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's pretty much it. You have our recommendations and comments.
All right. I'm going to go around the board. We start with Peter tonight.
It looks like the applicant has done pretty much everything they were asked to do. Looks fine.
Thank you. Carl?
It looks good to me, too. It looks, you know, from the elevations, looks like you're trying to match the architecture and everything of the existing building. Looks like it fits right in.
Good. Ed?
Yeah, based on certain inputs I've heard, been told about, this is long overdue and well welcomed. So looks great and good luck. I hope it goes well and fast. That's it.
I like it, no problem.
Okay. I'm no problem either. I think it's certainly needed. I think you guys do a great job up there, so that's good. I'll make the motions if it's all right with you. I move the planning board waive site plan public hearing for this project in accordance with Town Code Section 210-151D.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 5-0. I move the planning board as lead agency, therefore, hereby determines that the Children's Home Addition site plan would not have a significant effect on the environment, and no environmental impact statement will be required for the reasons set forth in the secret negative declaration for an unlisted action dated May 19th, 2016.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Call a question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Move the planning board grant conditional site plan approval for the Children's Home Addition site plan subject to the following 1-7 and architectural review that we will do next.
Second.
Okay, call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Are you prepared to do architectural this evening?
No. Next meeting.
Okay.
For next month.
All right. So we will you'll get on the calendar for June.
Yes.
And do architectural review. Okay. Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wow.
What's the date of the June meeting, Carol? Do you know?
Yeah, it's June 16th.
16th? Okay. June 16th. Thank you. Okay. Okay. Sherwin Williams. Williams, 684 Dutchess Turnpike site plan. Planning board has declared intent to be lead agency. And site plan review for redevelopment of the former Hollywood Window Company site, including building removal, construction of a new 4,000 square foot Sherwin-Williams Paints retail building, and associated parking lot modifications. 684 Dutchess Turnpike, Zone BN, Neighborhood Business District, 0.347 acres. Nicholas Pizza III, is the owner. Now we're disappointed. You don't have any videos? He paints it. Okay. I'll let you guys make the presentation, okay?
Good evening. My name is Christopher Lapine with the Chazen Companies.
Douglas Brunner, BKA Architects.
And Tom Godfrey, Granite Development. We are the proposed developer of this project, which is located at 684 Dutchess Turnpike. It's actually at the corner of Dutchess Turnpike and Peckham Road. The building currently, or formerly, was used as the Hollywood Window Company. Our proposal is to basically redevelop the site, to demolish the building, and basically rebuild in the exact same location, a new building of basically a similar size, do some minor grading and improvements to the parking area, bring things up to code, and do some work on the front in terms of closing down one of the curb cuts, removing some pavement, adding some landscaping and a sidewalk along the front edge, doing some screening to our residential abutter in the rear with a fence, and designing a new building for Sherman Williams. The Sherman Williams building is approximately 4,000 square feet, be oriented similar to the way the Hollywood Window Company building is oriented. The parking lot is closest on the uphill side towards the animal hospital, so that will get reused, cleaned up. Their front entrance would be in a similar location, a little closer to Dutchess Turnpike, so that we can make that an ADA accessible entrance. It currently is not in that location. The way their stores work is they've got an approximately 2,000 square foot area in the front, which acts as their sales floor. And then behind that, they've got an area of approximately 2,000 square feet that houses their tint room, manager's office, the restrooms, and a storage area towards the rear of the building. So site has some challenges. It has some grading issues, and it's tight out there. We tried to keep everything as close to existing as possible and rework everything so that it functions for Sherman Williams, functions with current codes. And Chris and Doug will bring you through the details of the site and the architecture in terms of exactly what we're proposing.
Okay. Yeah, from the site perspective, I think Tom did a pretty good job here describing the entire project to you. I'm just going to add a few other items to that. The existing pavement along the north face of the building, where they're currently used for parking and access, the intent is to remove that as part of this project and create a landscape buffer within that area between Dutchess Turnpike and the proposed building. The site itself is in the neighborhood business district, and the existing building is non-conforming in terms of its front yard setback and its rear yard setback and impervious coverage. The rear yard setback required is 35 feet. The current building is set back only 20. We are proposing to increase that to 25 feet. The existing impervious area on the site is 76%. The town code is a maximum of 75. Through some additional landscaping, we've been able to reduce that to 72% and eliminate that variance that we thought we would need. With regards to the front yard setback, since we're situating the building within its same location, it's currently 6 foot away from the front yard, and the intention is to keep it 6 foot away from the front yard as well. Loading will be in the same area as Hollywood Blinds. It's to the rear of the building, facing the residential facility to the back. Taking that into consideration, as Tom mentioned, we've provided a 6 foot high fence in that area. We've also provided some additional landscaping and some architectural elements to make the building more pleasing than what the current facility is out there.
Great. Anything you do would be a big improvement.
Let's see. The staff, do you have the staff recommendation and comments from departments? I'm sorry. Go ahead, please. That's your time.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. We were fortunate enough to actually meet with staff to get their feedback to actually develop this design I'm going to show you tonight. I'm going to start over here with basically the front, which is going to be the front of the building proposed, which is where I believe the parking lot is for Hollywood Blinds currently. Basically, you're going to have a set of sliding doors with a generous expanse of storefront.
Excuse me?
Yes.
You're standing right in my line of
sight. Oh, I'm sorry. A good-sized storefront to actually allow a lot of natural light into the sales area and whatnot. The building is flanked with decorative cultured stone columns, or pilasters actually, which is actually a field stone, and the color is to match the actual masonry of the wall as well. And the facade is broken up with two additional pilasters to give it a little bit more verticality. The top is capped with a stucco drive-it system in a lighter tan and capped with a decorative classical cornice. Moving on to Dutchess Turnpike, we were sensitive to the requirement that most public-facing roads require windows. We proposed spandrel glass, actually, just to actually meet that requirement. Unfortunately, we have fixtures behind here, shelving, so actually opening up the windows to the storefront, the actual sales area, is going to be very difficult. And we have stock room back here, so even though we're showing windows, they're not going to be visible to the inside. The secondary egress door is also located on Dutchess Turnpike, and it's going to be colored the same color as the stone and the brick, just to basically blend in and whatnot. And the decorative cornice, the classical cornice, continues along the side face. The parking lot side and Dutchess Turnpike side are the two sides with the signage. Turning the corner onto Peckham Road, we also maintained the two spandrel glass as well, and capping it, or I'm sorry, two pilasters basically framing both sides of the building. Moving over here where the existing receiving is right here, we're going to be maintaining the existing receiving and basically also cap or framing the building with the two pilasters on either side and whatnot. These colors are pretty much Sherwin-Williams preferred colors, the light tan on the top, giving more of a light effect, and the darker brown on the bottom to give it more of a grounding effect. And I just wanted to give you a brief overview of the existing building. So this is where the side where the Sherwin-Williams parking and the main entry is proposed. This is Peckham Street, and this is Dutchess Turnpike for Hollywood Windows. And I welcome your comments and questions. Okay. Thank you.
I assume you're going to use Sherwin-Williams paints to paint. Yeah.
It's actually mandatory that every product on site be Sherwin-Williams and no competitors' names, and that's actually in the agreement.
Okay, good. Eric?
Sure.
I like Sherwin. I know it.
Let's see. This is the first time this has been in front of the board. So the action for the board tonight is only to declare its intent to be lead agency for the environmental review. And we took the liberty of circulating that already, so we're suggesting the board authorize circulation of the notice, which you have a copy there. That way the applicant, if they're able to make a quick turnaround to the submittal, could return in the month of June. And I think the deadline is on Monday.
I think we got to go to the zoning board first.
Well, let's get through this part first, and we'll have some discussion. Let's see. The comments of the staff. We don't have a lot of comments, but there are a few. I guess there's a little, it was a little unclear as to the circulation around the building, and if the Peckham Road driveway seems to be a constraint in width. And it's not clear if it's intended to be one-way or two-way and how it's going to function as a loading area. Also, the town engineer, I'm not here tonight, but his primary concern was that the utility pole Relocation of the utility pole seems to be pretty key, and there's no guarantee that the utility companies will do it, so he was looking for some assurances that it would be moved, which would be fairly essential to the site plan. So he's looking for a commitment one way or the other on that. Otherwise, there may need to be some redesign of the driveway. Do you want to?
Yes, I can add a little bit to that. Actually, this afternoon, I did have a meeting on site with Central Hudson regarding the utility pole relocation. So I met with Casey Gunther out there and another gentleman. We reviewed the services that are on the pole, and the engineer is correct. It is very busy with services, both telephone and telco, but they are investigating it. We reviewed what needed to be done and potential relocation spots, what would work for them. So they are moving forward with trying to figure out exactly what's on it, where it goes, and how the relocation would work. Currently, for services off of that pole, it services our building overhead, and it also services the residential house behind us overhead for electric. Underground, there's two telecom underground conduits that they're not sure where those go. One could go into our building. They're not sure where the other one goes. And there's one potential underground electrical service. It's not servicing the house. It's not servicing the tire facility next door on the other side of Peckham Road. So they need to figure out where that service, if it's live, and where it may go.
Wow. I guess you dig it up, you'll find out.
But yes, we
it's been there a long time.
We intend that to be a two-way egress road in the rear there.
That's intended for two-way?
Yes.
Access?
Yep.
It's going to be tight. Okay. Otherwise, we have a number of comments to be filled out. Some of it is informational on the site plan checklist. Trash enclosure location, we'll need some information to address how you're going to handle that. Lighting. Those are our comments. I guess I'll just mention with your next submittal, you might want to give us some updated elevations or renderings. I noticed at least one difference on the elevation that you gave us was missing the egress door you mentioned on Dutchess Turnpike. So I understand you're tweaking things all the time, but for the next time around, when you're ready for architectural after site plan, you could come equipped with additional elevations and renderings up to date for the board.
Yep, we're working with Sherman Williams right now on the floor plan, trying to land that second egress door, which is required. It's just a matter of trying to get it to work with kind of their internal layout and functioning with the codes. Mm-hmm. It's my understanding the secondary egress cannot be in the warehouse area. It needs to be closer to the front where the public can egress without going through the back storage area. So working through that now.
I also just, I guess partly on the engineer's behalf, I heard in secondhand yesterday that the highway department reported that they believe the catch basin right by the driveway to be a DOT catch basin, not a town catch basin. So
on 44?
No, the one on Peckham Road, right by the driveway. So I can't. I told Chris I can't verify that. This is just from a quick field look by the highway department staff. So that would be something I would imagine may be important to look into since you're looking to hook into it.
We can reach out to Chuck Walters, DOT, on that issue. That is the. It's interesting. It's the beginning of actually a town drainage line, and that's there's no DOT connection from Route 44 to it. So that's baffling. That is the first catch basin on that road.
It might go the same place as that electric line. You don't know where it goes.
I thought Craig was the engineer tonight.
Yeah,
wearing a lot of hats today.
Okay, thanks, Aaron. Carl, we'll start with you.
Sure. I'm glad to see the plan includes the sidewalks and crosswalk markings, and the landscape buffer in front is great. You've gone ahead and matched a lot of our code issues. I did want to note what the county noted it also. The west end of the sidewalk there does not have the ADA strip going down and should be lined up better with the existing sidewalk on the other side of Peckham Road there. So that would complete the sidewalk plan there. And you have the sidewalk spur coming into your front door there, correct? I did have a question on the fence that was provided, what type of fence and color kind of thing, or any input for the residential?
Input from the residential neighbor?
Yeah.
I'm not sure if that house is occupied or vacant or what's going on with that, but I'm not sure what we specified.
Yeah, we called out a either a beige vinyl or a cedar based upon if we got some input from the neighbor, but we have not received anything.
Mm-hmm. All right. Vinyl kind of thing. Sounds good.
We're also trying to get some confirmation from the neighbor about removing the existing side driveway that's on their property.
Yeah, the extra pavement.
And restoring that.
Mm-hmm. We have to be concerned, like we did with the animal hospital, about the fence having a gap from the turtles. Remember the issue with the turtles on the...
We'll have to check. Actually, the EAF mapper showed the radius is being further away for this.
Okay.
So I'm not sure. We'll have to double check.
All right. I just remember we made sure that the fence would be a little bit higher off the turtle.
Okay, so there's room for them to crawl under if need be.
They could be in the catch basin.
And what kind of lighting is going to happen as far as a word more about light spillage to the neighbor as well, because it's so close, even with the fence? What kind of thing is happening at night?
Yeah, we've shown on our photometric plan there's less than a tenth of a foot candle before it hits the property line, and that's right at the fence line.
Sounds good. What else did I have here? We talked about the utility pole. That's good. Trash enclosure. I didn't see a trash enclosure.
Yeah, we've been back and forth with Sherwin-Williams on that issue. We think we're going to need one at this point. We thought we might be able to get away with a couple of the 55-gallon, but that's not the case.
So you have any idea where on the plan it will go? Or?
I think the best location for it is at the radius.
Yeah, that back corner there.
Yeah.
Okay.
It could be hit into the topography there.
Just I saw there's that huge poplar tree that was mentioned somewhere, and that you were trying to keep that, so that was good. I did wonder about parking. What percentage of the showroom is actual, like, retail space or storage rooms and things like?
2,000 square feet of the building is actually for showroom, and the other 2,000 square feet is for office and storage. We understand in the neighborhood business district that it's a requirement of 4 spaces per 1,000 square feet. Theoretically, this would require 16 spaces. We are asking for a waiver or relief of that, as only 2,000 square feet of this facility is actually for retail space.
Okay.
They have at the most 2 employees there during peak times, so that would leave 8 additional spaces available on the site.
You're asking for a waiver from 16 to 10?
16 to 10.
You've already noted that you have the impervious underneath the codes. If we added more spaces, I guess that would require variance on the impervious as well.
Yeah.
But
one of the things we tried to do with the spaces were, you know, in some cases making them less than 5% in terms of the slope. Some of them are currently greater than a 5% cross slope on them right now. So the topography out there is tough in terms of adding an additional space on the eastern portion of the site. And we've also created ADA accessible spaces where there currently are none on the site right now.
Okay. I was just concerned about getting... You know, if you do business where you're fully parked, then you wind up with people on Peckham Road, and it's a narrow road to begin with, park along. But, the last comment I have, I guess, is, truck deliveries. What kind of truck size and how often it delivers? Again, I'm concerned about noise for the neighbor, because
yep.
It's right
in terms of frequency, I believe they do one delivery a week. The last store that we did was typically on a Thursday or a Friday during normal business hours. They take one delivery. It's typically an in-house or a Sherwin-Williams truck that actually delivers.
Mm-hmm.
Here we've got a double man door planned on the back with an internal lift So they'll unload there, and they typically have a
hand truck,
that they'd bring the product
so
in.
So it's not a full eight.
It's a WB50 maximum size truck that would be coming there.
Okay.
That's a big truck. That's a big box truck. Isn't that a big truck?
It's pretty big.
The biggest one, but it's
on the fire truck.
Than the WB40 we use for a fire truck.
Considerable. You got to show the truck turning and stuff. I see.
Yeah, we can accommodate both that and the fire truck. We ran radiuses on with the current driveway in the rear is about 11 to 12 feet wide as it comes up, and then it kind of expands to about 15 or 16 feet. We've got about 21 feet in our width in the rear of it that's shown on our plans.
Does it work if it's fully parked? If there's cars in all the spots, will the truck still be able to get in?
Yeah, the truck will get in because there is no parking along the Peckham roadside.
Right. Is it going to get back in, or is it going to be able to go around, or how are they going to?
It'll pull in on the Peckham roadside
and back,
and then go back out onto Route 44 Dutchess Turnpike.
Okay. The alternate route we studied, but we discounted, was using the existing curb cut, which we're proposing to close down. The truck would have to pull in along the front of the existing front of the building and unload there, and would have to leave the pavement. Truck movement is a little easier. The turns aren't as hard, but then you would be leaving the pavement on the front of the building. The truck would be unloading on the front, would have the doors on the front, so we kind of forced it to the rear. The grading's a little difficult back there, but we felt that was a better solution.
Plus, we believe the DOT, as we've shown on our plans, it's going to eliminate that entryway on the west side of the property.
Which is okay.
Yeah, that's a good thing, less curb cuts. I guess the last comments I have are architecture-wise. Where's the HVAC? Is that on the roof or the ground?
It's going to be on the roof.
And how hidden is that?
On the front portion where the higher parapet is, it'll be pretty screened coming up 44. But the lower parapets, it'll be a little visible. You might need some rooftop screening.
I'm just saying, you know, as other buildings in the Arlington section, if you look at the Arlington Automotive and the Animal Hospital and up the road, you know, where there's more hip roof style and things. So that's, I don't know if that's something you want to relook at or not, but depends what the rest of the board thinks as well.
When we discussed this with staff, it was suggested because the building scale is so small that full pitch roof just wouldn't look right proportionally on this building.
Okay, that may be true.
Okay. All right.
That's all I have.
They're going to be back, so. You know.
Yep.
Thank you. Ed, anything you want to add?
I think Carl covered most everything I had. The only thing I was curious about is your frontage, which is these blank windows and brick. It just doesn't excite me. What I mean by that is, here it is, a paint store, and from what I gathered, what you said is 2,000 square feet of showroom. So I assume that you're really not as much as the contractors. You're after the general public to come in and see this building or all of the displays and so on and so forth. I'm familiar with the Sherman and Williams down on Route 9, down by Vassar Road, which is a blah building. I don't know if this works zoning-wise, but I would think a mural in the center portion of that building might be a nice idea, or something else that's more attractive than just, it just doesn't hit me that well. So. Anyway, something to think about, and I don't know.
Kind of plain.
Zoning. Mural.
It's kind of plain.
Yeah, it's kind of plain. And
fake window.
I mean, it's the top of the hill, and I know it's a busy traffic area, but it might be something that would catch the attention of the general public. But I don't know if the corporation wants to keep it status quo, but think about it.
We'll look into it. I'm not sure if a mural is considered signage under the bylaw.
Well, that's why I said.
Which I've run into with other things.
But we've had some other cases where I can think of a TGI on Friday.
Yeah, they originally, I mean, I think the original signage had a Coke bottle and some other advertisement placed there. Once they took it off, it was no longer signage. It was a mural.
It's something that I leave for discussion. But at any rate.
I think kind of the intent was to put some focus on the entrance area and that end of the building where the parking is, and try to draw the eye and attention there to that corner and kind of the
I leave it to you. It's your business.
And 2,000 square feet of just sales area that limits the walls that you can put product on and whatnot. And that's operationally.
Leave it to the imagination. And the
those faux windows can be made to look more something. That's all. Ben? Anything at this point?
I think any comments I had have been addressed, but I do agree with Ed. If you're heading east on 44, you wouldn't really notice it. Going west, it's a lot more attractive. You might go the other way, you might just go by and say, oh, we just passed the Sherwin-Williams store. That's it.
Good point. Peter?
Just a couple. On the under the photometrics, did you say 1/10 of a foot candle at the
at the rear?
I share Carl's concern about the exposure of the HVAC on the roof. If there's something you could do to mitigate that, I think even our town code strongly I think it requires that a roof-mounted HVAC be screened somehow. And my other concern, again, is the neighborhood business district requires 4 parking spaces per 1,000 square feet. You're providing 10. My prediction is that, or I'm guessing, you know your business much better than I do, that in the morning, you know, when you have multiple contractors showing up for product, that you're providing 10 spaces, 2 for employees, leaving a balance of 8. If there's some way, if you look, I know it's the site is very, very tight. If you could find maybe 1 or 2 spots for additional parking, it would make a lot more sense. Just a thought, and would appreciate it if you'd just take a look at it and see if there's something that you could do.
Even if it's is there any way to land bank any additional parking or provide spaces for the employees that would be a little further? I don't know. Something to think about.
One of the things we might want to consider here is where we're locating the refuse enclosure area. Maybe that concrete pad in the front of it could be used maybe for the employee parking. You generally put a concrete pad in front of it for the loading purposes, and maybe that could.
Anything, just a little breathing room.
Yeah, okay.
The only last thing I have is thank you for selecting the town of Poughkeepsie to locate your business. We really appreciate it, and we'll work with you as much as we can.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. All right, I move that the Planning Board declare its intent to be the lead agency to coordinate the environmental review of the proposed project as an unlisted action and authorize the Planning Department's circulation of a May 16, 2016 notice of said intent, a copy of the EIF, and a copy of the application to the identified involved agencies.
Second.
Can I call a question? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 5-0. I move the Planning Board defer further action on the application pending establishment of the lead agency and direct the applicant to respond to comments of the Planning Board and those received from the town departments and agencies, including but not limited to the following 1 through 11, obviously the comments made this evening, and some of the things you should take, we ask you to take into consideration. Do we have a second?
Second.
Call the question. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries 5-0. When you come in, will you be ready to come in June next month? The middle date's Monday.
We're going to be submitting in June for the July meeting.
July meeting. Okay. That's good. I would come prepared for architectural review just on the off chance that if we do approve this, if we can do the architecture the same night, it helps you.
Okay.
I was surprised the prior applicant didn't have it with him, but that's, you know. Okay, that'd be good.
Sounds good.
Thank you.
Great,
thank you. And I agree with what Peter said. Thank you for choosing the town of Poughkeepsie for a second store. Okay.
Right.
farthest.
Moving. Okay, we should. Everybody tired? You want to take a break? Okay, application number three, site plan. Hyatt Place Hotel, architectural review for a proposed 95-room, four-story, 60,578-square-foot Hyatt Place Hotel, 98 parking spaces, South Road, U.S. Route 9, and Chief Road, Zone BH Highway Business District, 8.43 acres, SECRA, negative declaration adopted December 17, 2015, MVK Enterprises, Inc., owner.
Good afternoon.
Hello. Hello.
Hello. Hi, how are you?
Good. Your name, please?
Yes, Irfan Khan. And there was a letter from Town of Poughkeepsie Planning Board dated May 11th. There was some question, and I'd like to distribute some of the paperwork, but that will clear up some of the question there.
He's referring to some comments.
Well, that's okay. You can take it off. I don't think we need.
You're doing it. Hmm?
Is that this here?
It's up to you.
Thank you. Thank you.
What is the problem? Didn't hear about that. Not bad. Not bad. Yeah. Oh.
Just is this the Chris Lapine show tonight?
he called ahead every spot on the agenda.
No, I thought he was on vacation, so that's why I didn't bother him. Otherwise, I would have called him.
I am on vacation. The town of Poughkeepsie is a vacation spot.
Show business. Would you say that a little louder for the studio audience?
Thank you for being in town of Poughkeepsie for your vacation.
Yes, I chose the town of Poughkeepsie for my vacation. I had a number of locations to select from, and the town of Poughkeepsie was on my bucket list.
I would call this a workcation. Yes.
I call it a pocation.
He's risking the
bump.
Yeah.
Don't talk us out of it. So you want to go over a couple of conditions of the approval that we did when we approved this project?
That is correct.
Okay, it's just for information then?
Correct.
Because we're basically just here for to approve the architecture.
That is correct.
Okay.
So there was some question about issue how the porch is, some of the, in the rendering, it shows a flat looking building. So that's why I brought the architecture drawing, which shows all the details and what's where and the color wise and so on. There's a basically a combination of three different colors on the building. So as you see, there's a three different stucco color in the whole building and the brick. Basically, building, as you see on the drawing, is pretty straightforward. And if you have any question on that, please feel free to ask.
Irfan, we should.
Yep.
We should talk about the changes that were made.
Someone doesn't have this. Hmm?
Along the front of this building at one point in time, the applicant had shown kind of like a almost like a metal facade.
Yeah, I remember that.
And I know the board itself was not fond of that, so he's integrated some brick columns in this particular area.
Good.
And he's got a stucco finish over here where the Hyatt place is.
Okay.
And I know the other comment was to add some additional color besides the gray that was there, and he's integrated kind of this maroon here, and he's stuck with a manganese-type brick. Yes.
I could be the Vanna White.
You have the legs for it.
No.
It's good. I think it's pretty attractive.
Thank you.
I've been to other Hyatt places, and they all are nice-looking hotels.
Yes, they are.
Different than your usual box hotel kind of thing.
Like the portico.
Yeah.
I mean, just based on the original rendering that we present, it had commercial-looking silver glass panels and all that, so we changed that into a maroon color, and it looks much, much better.
Mm-hmm. A little warmer.
Yes.
I just had a quick question on the height variance. How does the height compare to the storage place next door? Do you know offhand, Chris?
In terms of number of stories, we're similar. Height, I think we might have been a couple feet higher, maybe one or two, but the zoning board granted the variance.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Just that angled rise of the roof. It's on the front, you know, looks nice. It stands up. I was just, on the side elevations.
Yeah,
it's not clear. What is it? Is it a solid structure? Does it have wings? Does it? Do you see it?
It's from this side. What you will see is an angle, slant angle, going up, and is the same width of that. Which let me just look it up.
This width, the width of this is the width of that going back.
Is a similar color what you see on the side of the building. It's more the metallic color.
It looks to be fairly wide from the end view.
Correct.
Is that hiding HVAC and stuff up there as well, or? I mentioned.
Here, Carl's. I mean.
Yeah, if you look from the end view, you know the next.
This one down below,
the south, the view from the south, from the north. I mean, it looks like a gray.
That's.
Looks grayish.
If you look at the handout, it's actually hiding the mechanicals for the elevator. You're seeing in the backside.
Okay,
you won't see it from the road.
So these wings.
Yeah, it's not really. It doesn't show up on this drawing, but you can see it on this.
So this comes out.
Carl, it's probably about 5 to 8 feet, maybe in width. The architectural plans aren't to scale here. But in relationship to the building, I can kind of guesstimate the range.
Okay, I wasn't sure how huge it was and where the HVAC was going to go. Because you're coming down a hill from both sides almost.
There's your mechanical equipment going.
Good.
Right behind.
Make a motion to accept architectural.
Do you have a second?
Show us.
Okay. Moved and seconded. We accept the architecture as presented. Call the question. Those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 5-0.
To answer that last question you just asked, the mechanical is actually hidden behind here.
That one.
Yeah. That's what I thought. Okay.
When do you expect to get started? I know you did the tree thing and all, right?
Did the tree thing. We are waiting on the DOT approval.
Okay.
For some of the grading in the front, and we're working with the Department of Health on their approval.
Good.
So.
Good. Okay. Great. We can certainly use it. So I think it's good.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Really appreciate it.
Good luck.
Thank you.
I think it would be very nice. Okay. Hudson Valley Federal Credit Union discussion. Someone here for Dunkin' Donuts? Are you? No, okay.
Have a nice Memorial Day.
I was going to say we would do that first in case somebody was waiting for that. Thank you. You too.
Thank you.
Hudson Valley Federal Credit Union. This is a discussion regarding Coppola's restaurant site, the old treasure chest, the corner of Route 9.
Thank you.
2373 South Road, US Route 9, Zone BN, neighborhood business, 1.37 acres, Antonio Coppola, owner. Known to most of us as the treasure chest.
I lived there for...
Yeah. Spent many a long night there.
Yep, I know. I'm just texting more.
Okay. Is this right now?
That's correct.
Mr. Chairman, if I could just maybe just some sort of opening remarks here and an explanation about the project is being presented tonight. We were actually approached probably maybe 3 months ago by representatives from the Hudson Valley Federal Credit Union. They're looking for a new location, preferably out on Route 9. They've actually sold the building where they're in at the end of Ivy Road, and they have a lease back for a couple of years, which would allow them to, you know, some time to identify a location. So they had approached us about the Coppola's restaurant, the treasure chest, and we also brought in at that point in time our town historian John Pinna. To try to understand some of the historic aspects of the site. Basically underneath the, John actually was able to find quite a bit of information about the site. I mean, it dates back to the 1740s, apparently the home of the original highway superintendent or the highwayman, the king's highwayman, going back to 1740s. But the structure has been altered profoundly over the years, and it was actually rejected for inclusion on the federal and the state historic registry back in the mid-1980s because of the changes to the structure. But underneath all of the stuff that's been added on over the years is a roughly about a 1,500 square foot, two-story structure, the original home. One of the things that we had asked the credit union and their architects and engineers to do is to evaluate what, if any, of that, just the original structure, not all the stuff that got added on later on, could it be used? Could it be incorporated into a new construction? And if so, what that might look like? And if not, let's have a conversation then about what could be accomplished on this site. So I think that we've worked our way through some of the issues at the credit union and Mario Associate JT Singh. I think they've done a wonderful job on sort of figuring out what can be used, what can't be used. Bottom line is that the age of the structure and the trying to match up new construction with old, it becomes a real building code compliance nightmare. So what you're going to hear is a discussion about a new building on that site with due consideration for potential reuse of certain parts of the architectural elements of the original structure in some way as part of maybe a cosmetic additions to the new structure. But with that said, I thought it was probably about time to kind of bring the conversation forward. This is a discussion for the board tonight. Just kind of, you know, get a flavor for the kind of ideas that we've been kicking around for the past couple of months. So with that said, I'll turn it over to Jay.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. Jay Deesing, Mori Architects. I'm here with Roger Keating, Jason Companies. Scott Brady is here with Turner Construction, and then some representatives from the credit union. Neil stole about three quarters of my speech, so this is going to be real easy. But I'll just go through a brief overview of our project. As Neil mentioned, the building down on Barnegat Road has been sold. The credit union has a lease there for a period of time, and we're looking to build or to open a new branch at the corner of IBM and South Road. So the existing site's about 1.4 acres. There's entrances to the site off of IBM Road, which I'm sure you're familiar with, and then there's two curb cuts off of South Road. So the existing site has about 90 plus or minus parking spaces. With the existing building and some of the outbuildings in the back, it approaches about 10,000 square feet of footprint on the site. So as we kind of just started to talk about, the main or the original building in that conglomeration there is right towards the front of the site on South Road, and it's that small rectangle. You guys probably might not be able to see that, but it's this rectangle right here in the middle, and then the rest of the surrounding structures were added over time. So, you know, we went down, we surveyed that building, we looked around. As Neil mentioned, we had some meetings with Neil, John Pinna was there, and Eric Holman was there, and we kind of went through and discussed some ideas of what can be done, either reusing some of the building or constructing a new structure. So, as you can see, a lot of the building is concealed, the original building is concealed by some of those additions. This is from the south. The latest addition was the big dining room at the back of the building, which actually our office did around 2000. And then a view from the north. It's a kind of not a great picture, but again, you can see all the structures that were added in the new building, or the original building in the middle. So basically, we've arrived at, you know, kind of discussing the opportunity to put a new building on this site. The existing structure, if we were to try to use that original building, peel away all the old additions, it would be tough to do that. We would be left with not a lot of the original structure there based on the additions and the holes that were made in the original walls to get to the additions. So it'd be a challenge to do that. So what we've started to think about is building a new building there. And, you know, we've started to look at a site plan and how we could efficiently lay out a site to work for the credit union. So what we're looking to do is to, our design places the building roughly in the same spot as the original. We are maintaining the curb cut off of IBM Road and one of the curb cuts off of South Road, the one that's shared with the hotel. And then we're proposing to close up the curb cut that was kind of in the middle of the site closer to IBM Road. So we're proposing about a 4,300 square foot branch with a detached drive-through structure on the south end of the site. We're proposing, that's the drive-through. We're proposing about 45 parking spaces. And then with our smaller building and about half as many parking spaces on the site, you know, we're substantially increasing the pervious area and the green space on the site, which benefits both visually and in our stormwater management design that we'll get into in the details as we go. Another nice little feature is there's a existing sidewalk that's down in front of the hotel, and we're going to be extending that across our project and then tying into an existing crosswalk that goes across South Road and then heads up further north.
So, mind if we ask questions as you're going?
Well, sure, go ahead.
I'm just curious, it's the amount of parking at the existing site today versus the amount of parking here.
There's about 90 spaces on the existing site, so we're about half as many.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's considerably less.
I mean, how's that detached drive-through work? That's what I was wondering about. Is that
the pneumatic tubes that go underground?
It's all just tubes, so you're just talking to somebody.
Into that parking space, they go into that parking space.
So you're not talking to somebody face-to-face then, you're just over speaker or something?
Yeah, it's over speaker, then there's monitors where the teller can see the customer.
Okay, that's what I was wondering.
Yep.
That would be good.
This is, it's something that's done at a lot of their other branches. We're doing this, actually, we're just starting a branch out in LaGrange, and we're doing a detached structure like that, similar to this, so it's pretty common. There's one in Pleasant Valley.
Hollowbrook,
down in Wappinger, so it's pretty commonplace for the credit union.
Your feeling is that the parking, though, is sufficient because you don't have the staff offices that you used to have, which are now open on Portman Road. Is that correct?
You know, most of our branches average kind of in the neighborhood of about 50 spaces. So as far as in comparison to the main building down in Barnegat, that was three stories of a lot of administration that's moved over to Boardman Road.
That's what
so,
I was
yeah, all
and all of that is shifted over now.
That's correct.
That move is all complete.
That's correct.
Is there a drive-up ATM here in one of these?
That'll be in that structure, so there'll be two teller lanes and then a drive-through ATM lane.
Okay.
Is all the Visa offices also moved over to Barnegat Road?
All
Visa, the Federal Credit Union Visa, used to be on the second floor, I believe, or something like that.
Yes, everything is over on Boardman Road now.
Okay, thank you. Right.
So really what we're talking about then is this is just the retail banking.
Just a
typical branch.
Just a typical branch.
Yeah.
And the buildings that were back here, they're going to be, that's basically, they were there, now the garages?
The old barn.
Yes, so those will be removed. There's some parking that's near the southern end of the site in the back. So, you know, that is going to kind of get some landscaping there, but we're going to have a bank of parking there really dedicated for employees. So, you know, one thing to point out is this is a residential zone back here, and there is the 65-foot setback to that residential zone that we've maintained for the buildings and whatnot.
I think that house directly behind it, it looks abandoned and all overgrown. I think that's a commercial zone.
It is a commercial
zone. Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, so I think that one is right in here on the corner.
Correct.
Right. But, yep. But then the next one over is residential.
Yeah, and it's pretty heavily screened there naturally right now, yep, with trees and shrubs and whatnot. So this really should not be any impact to the neighbors.
Yeah. If you call that screening. I guess, you know, the only... it's great that you connect into the sidewalk system on the front along Route 9, but people get off the bus stop there, and I come out on IBM Road at least once a day, and there's people walking down the lane because...
Because there's no sidewalk there.
Because there's no sidewalk. We asked the business behind there to start a sidewalk in there, and then that plant, they never wound up building there, but I think you should start a sidewalk down that direction.
To go down IBM Road?
To go down IBM Road.
Okay, we can look at that.
Get that started.
Certainly can look at that. So I mentioned that rear setback to the residential properties, but all of our whole project meets all the bulk regulations, the setbacks and whatnot, mm-hmm, in the BN zone. So, you know, we're in good shape with all of that. So, you know, once we got this site kind of roughed out, we started thinking about a building design. And just to show you some of the other branches we've done, Fishkill, we just opened last year. And this is down on the former Denny's site just north of Route 84. So this is a little bit more contemporary building. It's got a ground-faced masonry facade, hip roof structure, and then it's got a clear story in the center of the branch that lets natural lighting down into the lobby, which is really a nice feature.
So this would be very similar to that?
No, we've done in discussions with, you know, some of the meetings we've had with Neil and John Penn, we're looking to kind of design a building that may adapt some features from the existing original building, but be a little bit more modern, especially on the interior for the bank's needs. So what we came up with is a design possibly something like this. So this is a traditional gable structure. We have a column structure that was on, similar to what was on the original building. Before all the additions, there was a front porch there, so we've emulated that kind of design. So we have a deep roof overhang on the front. And then similar to what I just showed you in Fishkill, on the roof we have a dormer structure, which will let natural lighting down into the bank branch, or into the union branch.
What's the roofing material?
This roofing material, so the most of it, or the majority of it, would be a architectural roof shingle. Mm-hmm. And then what we're proposing is some areas we would have some accents of the standing seam green metal roof that we do on a lot of the other branches for the credit union. You know, we've designed in some features
nice,
similar to the existing building is we have these chimneys that flank on the two sides. So that's a feature we took from the original building. We have a nice traditional brick water table from the ground up to the windowsills, and then we're anticipating a clapboard-type siding material, which was on the original building when it was built.
Yes, any thought to using, I mean, I know there's going to be some historical issues perhaps, but any way to use some of the existing timbers into the design?
Yep. Yes, we're considering
that. And all
the
business cards are gone now, that used to be.
We're looking at some of the brick. There's brick from the chimney we might possibly use. There's wood plank flooring on the interior of the building. We've thought about using that as wainscoting or as, you know, wall paneling to try to repurpose some of those existing materials. So that's something that we will be looking into as we go along.
You're keeping the old bar in the basement?
That's been everybody's number one question.
Another good question.
It has been the number one question.
It has. Unfortunately, the basement is tough because it's so low, and there's not a lot we can do with that.
I got a few bruises.
actually, kind of getting back to Peter Carl's question, you know, one of the
the things that we have been talking about, and we can't answer at this particular point in time because there's just stuff that has been applied to the exterior of the building. There's aluminum siding, there's brick, there's all this stuff. You actually have to start peeling that off to understand what, if anything, on the exterior, you know, the clapboard siding, can it be used? Or is it, you know, is it rotten? Is it falling? There's stuff that you just don't know.
I was thinking more like timbers from the bar.
Yeah, but, you know, you go inside and, you know, you do, you can see the hand-hewn beams. A lot of them, however, you know, they're kind of doing one of these. So I, my guess, and it's subject to, you know, obviously engineering and architectural consideration is, you know, you're hopefully we can end up with some pieces that might be used to dress up the foyer. I don't think you're going to end up with anything necessarily that's going to be structural. It's
No, it wasn't code today. I didn't think so.
But yeah, to the extent that they're able to salvage those materials, this will be kind of a work in progress going forward once they start kind of pulling things apart. It is also one of the key, the questions that John Pinn, our town historian, has asked, and you know, some of it we just can't answer at this point. And you know, by the way, John has been on the job, I think, maybe roughly about a year, and he's been great to work with on this project as well as Hudson Heritage, and he's a real resource. He dug out files showing pictures of this structure with the, you know, the family who was living in there going back to, you know, the 1800s. I mean, so we've got some real good documentation about what the original structure looked like and consisted of. But there are parts of this that we're just not able to answer at this particular point in time.
I really appreciate that the credit union is even taking the time to focus on that and look at the history.
Yeah, you know, we had a number of inquiries, mostly fast food restaurants wanted to locate here, which I think would be an utter disaster for this corner. This is zoned for neighborhood business, not highway business, and the neighborhood business does not allow drive-up restaurants. So that was an easy answer, but it does allow for drive-ups for financial institutions. And of course, you know, we want to, you know, have the credit union has been you know, a resident in the town for a long time, and we want to try to accommodate their growth and their need to be out on Route 9. And this, you know, we've worked through a lot of issues here. I mean, personally, this seems kind of a win-win.
Yeah, but you could get
ATM. There's still going to be questions going forward. You know, we're going to have, you know, hearings. People are going to have comments that here. But I think this is a really great start.
A lot of hotel guests nearby could use the ATM, perhaps. So.
One of the things that we spoke about at the meeting we had a couple of weeks ago, that they would perhaps in the lobby have some kind of a display highlighting the things that were on that site, you know, paying some respect to.
Maybe photos or something, I don't know.
Yeah, one thing that credit union does collage. Do in a lot of, almost all their branches, is they do some historical photographs of the town or the village that the right. branch is in to right. really highlight the history of that area. So we have intentions certainly to do that.
You know, the other thing too, you know, it's been great working with the credit union on this. You know, Tony Rohrmeyer is here. You know, the their willingness to come forward with a design that is, you know, maybe not typical of something maybe that they recently built further south, but they've done this before. They've got a store out in Pleasant Valley that, you know, I mean, it looks great. So they're you know, there's not a rigid adherence to a particular architectural style. It's, you know, they're looking to fit the building into the site, and I, you know, so that's what we're talking about here tonight.
Thank you. Any other questions, comments? I think you got a good project here, and I think you can tell that the board is certainly in favor of, you know, looking into this and going, moving it forward and getting that corner cleaned up and putting a viable business. And you know, it's, you know, we gotta move things forward. Ed, yes.
I have one more question
about the bar.
When do you see most of the traffic for banking, in the morning or in the early evening, you know, 4 o'clock-ish kind of thing?
You know,
I'm just thinking about the traffic circulation and...
Yeah, you know, Tony may be able to answer this better than me, but these branches are pretty steady as far as traffic, but what is the peak, Tony?
Yeah, usually...
You gotta take the microphone, Tony, please. I have a question also.
So usually we have days of the week that are more busy than others. Like Fridays, for example,
right.
are busy typically all day long. But you know, it has peaks and valleys. Mondays tend to be somewhat busy, and it also depends somewhat on the time of the month. If you know, paydays and first part of the month are usually busier than others, but you know, we I think we, based on what we've seen here and what we plan to do, I think the corner can accommodate the traffic that we're going to put there.
Yeah, I was just concerned. I'm very familiar with the Wappingers branch, and I've seen peak times there and
yep.
not so peak times and
yes.
so forth. But having worked at that site, I know how congested that corner can get. Not as much as it used to, but
right. One of the things we discussed is that traffic is going down that road anyway.
Right. I'm just concerned about conflicts. You know,
mm-hmm.
all of a sudden right. you stop and you got everybody kind of and. If you're late for work, they're going to go right over you. So just one of those things. That,
yeah.
Any rate, I'm sure you're going to have to look at that through this whole thing, traffic buildup.
Yeah, I mean, that
can you have a slide of the intersection that you
sure.
put up?
I mean, the IBM road connection has always been a tight, tough spot to get in and out of if you're trying to get out that direction.
I kind of need that blown up. All right. One of the things we talked about was the traffic going south on Route 9, then making the right on IBM Road and potentially making that quick left into your parking
right,
lot.
That's right.
We talked about perhaps channeling the traffic. And
yeah.
So that's a big concern. And I'm sure, and I think you and I just talked about that a little bit, that we need to address, you need to address to get it the best we can, because you know people tend to cut across, and it's pretty wide there.
Even going northbound, to, you know, turning left into IBM Road and then left again.
Yeah, yeah.
There is a left turn going northbound that crosses Route 9 at the hotel entrance now.
Yes.
So
yeah.
a lot of northbound traffic will enter that way. So I don't anticipate a lot of people going onto into IBM Road and then making.
Oh, they'll come in through the hotel entrance.
Yeah, the hotel right. entrance.
And it's all connected. Okay.
Yeah, it's right, and
that's
we're going
that's a northbound.
I mean, yeah,
northbound can enter
yeah.
there as well as southbound.
Right. Yeah. Because
yeah,
you have access that
this
entrance.
This curb cut is going to close.
Correct. Okay, that's what I was.
And then this one is a northbound entrance
this
in.
Closes, sorry.
Northbound entrance in, and southbound also enters in here. So this is shared with the hotel.
Right.
So once people get the idea where it is, the safest, easiest way to actually be just to use that entrance.
Right.
Yeah.
That's the intent.
We need to try to discourage people. And again, it's up to the traffic engineers.
Yeah, that's always been my preferred.
Doing this and then, you know, across
to the site. So,
you know,
going across three lanes here.
I mean, especially at quitting time, where there's three lanes of traffic sitting there waiting and backing up past the driveway. So,
yeah, absolutely. You know, we're obviously going to talk with DOT. Roger's had a preliminary conversation with them, but we're going to, you know, get their input as well. So, we'll see what they say about this intersection.
Okay. Good. Good. Great. Thank you. Let's keep moving along.
Yeah, I guess our plan is to probably make a formal submission and get back before you probably in July, August sometime.
Yeah.
Excellent. We're going to make it go faster than you want to.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Have a good Memorial Day.
Yeah, you too. Take care.
Other business, Dunkin' Donuts, 764 Main Street, parking addition, time extension for a previously approved site plan to transform adjacent lots into overflow parking for an existing Dunkin' Donuts, 764 Main Street, Zone Arlington Town Center, 0.61 acres, negative declaration on listed action adopted June 20th, 2013, CRE Poughkeepsie LLC owner. So I move that, that's the wrong one.
Move the planning board grant a final time extension for the site plan construction completion from May 31st of 2016 forward to September 16th, 2016.
Second.
It's moved and seconded that we grant a final time extension for a site plan construction completion from May 31st, 2016 forward to September 16th, 2016.
They do look like they're coming along now.
Call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Yes, they are, and they should have it done within, say, 2 to 3 weeks.
Maybe we can use the same contractor half a block up the road on the right.
We Main and Raymond?
That's slow progress there, too.
You know, can we do something about Main and Raymond? Any other business that we need to discuss? Okay, I move that we adjourn a meeting.
Second.
Terminate it.
stand corrected. I move we terminate the meeting. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 5-0.